welcome to another episode of The Time Capsule. Today, we are all about pirates because, well, everybody loves pirates, right? Well, except maybe the Coast Guard. All joking aside, pirates have for centuries captivated the imagination of everybody around the world. And that includes us. So, we have it all today. Pirate history, legend, lore, pirates in fact and fiction, female pirates, Maryland pirate history. We got it all rolled into one. It's kind of like a giant pirate burrito. So, along on our journey today is our guest, Ken Courtney, actor, singer, musician, songwriter, reenactor, and also pirate. That's a lot of hats, Ken.
It is.
I mean, like a lot of different costumes. But today, you are rocking the pirate look, and you look amazing.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Cheryl Williams for the Time Capsule. Today, I'm on the eastern shore of Maryland in the town of Rock Hall, where every year, pirates, wenches, mateys, and sailors get together for the Pirates and Wenches Fantasy Weekend. This town was founded by Thomas Ringgold in the late 1600s by land deeded to him from Lord Baltimore. It's going to be a great weekend. There's plenty to do, plenty to eat, plenty to see, so let's get going.
Well, welcome back. I'm here with my guest, Ken Courtney. So, Ken, let's get started. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Well, I'm Ken Courtney. I do a lot of music, and I do a lot of acting as well. I'm frequently on the History Channel. I'm in the opening scenes of Morgan Freeman's Slavery and the Making of America, playing the concertina. I do a lot of things for the History Channel and so forth. So I keep busy.
Very good. Now I see you specifically today costumed as a pirate. So you want to tell me a little bit about what you're wearing, why you do the impression, a little bit about that?
Yeah, and I'm 1750s-ish the way I'm dressed right now. You can tell in French this is a V-E-S-T-E, vest. And it's a very long sleeveless coat is what it boils down to. And I've gotten some cotton slops on to keep me cool if I'm in the Caribbean or something like that. Of course, the long stockings are you know, what you think of, and the buckle shoes as well. And the tricorn hat, yeah.
So you also know quite a bit about pirates in general. Can you give us a little history, a little pirate history?
Well, if we're talking about the classic period of pirates, we're talking about the 1990s Somalia. Think about it. That was learned of the British intentions. Force marched his men into the city of New Orleans, declared martial law, met with the pirate Jean Lafitte at Lafitte's blacksmith shop on Bourbon Street in New Orleans. There they planned the defense of the city, which of course was successful as one of America's greatest military victories ever.
And now, it's worth mentioning, is actually very successful as one of the oldest running bars in America.
It is. A very, very quaint and wonderful place to be.
That's right, because you're from New Orleans, so you know all about that. Yes, definitely.
That's where you take your girlfriend when you really want to impress her.
And when we want to impress upon you at this point, I guess if we could take this a little further, is the difference between pirates and fact and fiction. So I think, as much as I love Robert Louis Stevenson, I have to be honest with you, I don't think he did much in terms of telling the truth about pirates. So,
well, from the standpoint of people dying as a result of buried treasure, there is an element of truth in there. But you got to figure the pirates on board ships were generally gangs, just like the gangs in Baltimore and New York. You know, you've got this thing, and they're very vicious, not only to outsiders in where they're plundering their booty, but to each other as well.
Yeah, yeah. And again, there's a very strong sense of justice, I think, because in many cases, these men and women, which we're going to get to, had not been gotten very good justice in their lives in general.
Well, you know, there's an element of truth to that, but there's also the element of, well, think about it. You know, if you're going to split the booty from a ship, if a certain number of your crew get killed, there's more booty for you. So
Good point. You had
that element, you know, working in there as well. And that's the cutthroat, stab in the back kind of pirate.
Definitely. Okay. So again, in terms of pirates in fact and fiction, it's interesting that you talked about the buried treasure, because I've heard two points of view on that. I've heard the first one is, well, you might bury the treasure, but like, why? Because the main thing was they wanted to get their hands on the loot and the booty, and this was the problem. These people had the potential to make some money, to do really well, to retire early, but there's a sort of mindset that goes along with that lifestyle that says if you've got it, spend it. So the tragic part of this was they had their freedom, they had the booty, they had the money, they had the women or the men or what have you, and then they get ashore, and this is where maybe fact and fiction sort of meet. They go to the bar, they have the bar fight, they spend the money, they wake up in the pig slop the next day, and they're right back where they started. So it was sort of a thing that fed on itself. As a pirate, as far as that actual lifestyle in fact went, now you sort of had to sign on with another crew. So it sort of was repeating the same thing. So a lot of these people may have had adventure, and they may have had freedom, but I'm going to guess the lifespan was pretty short.
Oh, sure. You know, you could equate it to, say, like the people in Baltimore who are drug dealers. You know, they make a lot of money, and then they spend a lot of money, and then they got to deal with more drugs, and it's an endless cycle until somebody gets shot.
Yeah, very sad. And again, it can be romanticized. There are parts of it that are certainly very interesting, parts of it that can certainly be romantic, but it was a hard and brutal life. It really
was. Sure.
Okay. So we're going to take a break at this point, but don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Hi, we're having so much fun here at Pirates and Wenches Weekend. It happens every year. We have a great time.
I hope I'll be able to see you.
Hi there.
Hi.
You're having a good time.
Yeah,
I know you are.
Fun. Yeah.
Awesome.
It's our girls' weekend. We have a good time.
Are you going to be asking me?
Okay. No, if you would just want to go ahead and start. All right, let's pull out here. Okay, and because the just speak loudly. Okay, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Joanne Rich, and this is my husband, Jim, and the two of us own Java Rock here at the corner of Sharp and Main in Rock Hall. And this is a very busy place on Pirates and Wenches Weekend, so I'm down here all weekend long instead of at the inn down the road, which we own, which is the inn at Huntingfield Creek. We are real homebodies in Rock Hall now after living an international life, and we love it here. But Pirates and Wenches is one of the most fun weekends you can possibly imagine in all of the Eastern Shore. Jim is the organizer, so maybe he can say a few words.
Yeah, so this is our 12th year. Festivals to go 12 years, you got to know people have a lot of fun. It's a pirate-themed festival. We have 50 crafters this year. We have a wonderful food court, plenty of entertainment. Down at the beach, we have steel bands. We've got the dinghy run, the poker run. There was a rum tasting last night at Osprey. There was a body sing-along at Beowulf. Tonight is the Buccaneers Pirates Ball at Waterman's. So we have a full weekend plan for everybody. On Sunday, we have costume contests, and the festival continues to 4 o'clock.
And lots of fun for kids, too.
Yes, plenty of kids' activity. This is a family event.
Good, how are you?
Good.
Okay.
Well, I'd like to introduce you to my cousin, who gave up being a privateer and took off being a private, and now he's a pirate without a body.
My pirate guest, Kent Courtney, who's going to give us a little tune. That was outstanding. That, by the way, is not the only instrument you play. How many instruments do you play, actually, Pirate Man?
I counted them. Most everything I put my hands to, except for things like saxophone, because I blow out my eustachian tubes if I do that.
But I'll tell you, and in addition, actually, we'll tell a little bit more about you. In addition to music, acting, songwriting, all different kinds of things, you know a whole lot about sailing. And in terms of pirates, we can't not talk about pirates and talk about sailing, and specifically the kind of sailing that made a pirate. And this is another thing. Between fact and fiction, we see in the movies these enormous pirate ships with the rigging and the sails. But you know, in real life, if you want to be a pirate, you've got to be stealthy, you've got to be quick in and quick out, and that means you use a small ship, am I right?
Well, yeah, the very fast ships are excellent. In fact, if you want to get an idea of the kind of shipping that could be used by pirates, Dale Gallen of Gallen Historical Art does some magnificent maritime images. He paints these things of these everything from schooners to the big sailed ships. And often those little schooners were very, very fast. And if you could come alongside somebody and, you know, throw guns at them and threaten them, then you obviously had the advantage over them, even if it were a much bigger ship. Well, like the Somali pirates, when they would go up against the great big container ships, they're coming up in a what was a, basically a large motorboat, and then, you know, killing the whole crew and then taking the ship into shore so they could plunder it. The same kind of mentality existed, and you can look at one of Dale Gallen's images and get the idea of, you know, wow, these are some small ships that actually went out in very big seas.
So it was definitely the whole idea, and again, this is right down to Captain Phillips and the Somalian pirates. It's this whole, like, David and Goliath sort of idea. Mm-hmm, quick, mm-hmm. Stealthy, in, out, quick, out. Mm-hmm, there mm-hmm. You go. That's how they did it. That's how they did it.
Sure, because when you think about a pirate chase, it's all about the wind back in the days before powered sails. The best way to get away from a pirate is to stay pointed as close to the wind as possible, and then, you know, tack back and forth. Every time you tack, you're going away from the pirate.
So we've talked a lot about pirates in other places, but you know, we had some pirate action right here in the state of Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
As early as 1635, there was a fellow named William Claiborne. And William Claiborne was actually a Virginian. Mm-hmm. He owned a small plantation on what is now Kent Island. Mm-hmm. And he decided that when he saw a Maryland ship encroaching on his territory, he sent an agent of his to attack that ship. And that kicked off over 200 years of piracy in Maryland. So we're going to talk a little bit about that when we come back. Don't go anywhere. Stick around. Well, time to take a break. Even pirates get hungry. Oh, and don't forget the hand sanitizer.
Thank you.
On the half deck, walking all about, there's the second mate, so steady and so stout. What he's a-thinking of, he doesn't know hisself. For wishing that he'd hurry up and strike the bell. Strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the wind, and you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike the bell. Down on the main deck, working at the pumps, there's the larboard watch all waiting for their bunks. They look out to sea and they see a great swell. They're wishing that the second mate would strike the bell. Strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the wind, and you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike the bell. Aft at the wheel, poor Anderson stands, grasping at the spokes with his cold-mitten hands. He looks at the compass, and the course is clear as hell. He's wishing that the second mate would strike the bell. Strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the wind, and you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike the bell. Up at the forecastle top, keeping sharp lookout, there is Johnny waiting, ready for to shout. Lights burning bright, sir, and everything is well. He's wishing that the second mate would strike. Strike the bell, strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the winner, you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike. Strike the bell. Upon the quarter deck, our gallant captain stands, looking out to sea with his glass in his hands. What he's a-thinking of, we know very well. He's thinking more of shortening sail than striking the bell. Strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the winner, you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike. Strike the bell, second mate, let us go below. Look well, the winner, you can see it's gonna blow. Look at the glass, you can see that it is fell. And we wish that you would hurry up and strike. Strike the bell.
Okay, ready?
That's nice. That's been covered by many people, but I think I like your version best.
Hey, thank you. Thank
sure,
you.
You're awesome. So you talked about being from New Orleans. You
yes,
want to talk,
yes, yes.
talk a little more about old New Orleans and how it was kind of, if not the Wild West, maybe the Wild Gulf? Right?
Well, not only for pirate shipping, but all shipping. You know, you talk about the, you know, the getting drunk and spending your money. Okay. It was very true that, you know, people from Liverpool, captains from Liverpool, would get their ships full of sailors, often largely Irish sailors, and then they'd do the cruise, get into New Orleans, and then they'd pay everybody in New Orleans for the whole cruise, knowing they would spend their money. They'd spend their money, they'd want to get back home, and then they'd go back to Liverpool, but they'd already been paid in New Orleans, so they weren't due any more money. And so then here you had this situation where they had to go sign back on again. And New Orleans was very much associated with that. Maybe some of their tourist industry had its roots in that kind of service.
Okay. So finally, and I know this is a bit whimsical, but what are pirates in modern day, if not a little bit whimsical? If you could pick a pirate name, what would it be?
Pirate name.
Yeah, and then I'll tell you mine.
Your pirate name.
Yeah, I'll tell you mine.
It would have to be like, you know, I like a lot of things that are associated with, like, you have Barnacle Bill and you have mollusks and, you know, clams and all of that
mollusks,
stuff. And you start
yeah.
thinking of it, and you could be like Krabby Kent.
Which is, like, so not you, but the alliterative value is, like, very high,
it would be
right?
Super.
Yeah. Yeah, I chose CC Cutlass, which stands for Chicken Caesar Salad Cutlass. Because wherever I go, I get a Chicken Caesar. I know, it's ridiculous.
Okay.
So this is what happens.
What do you do at an Indian restaurant?
Good point. Good point.
Yeah, I'll take the vegetable, anything. You know, vegetable korma.
Yeah, that's
it. One thing, did you ask him about Jean Lafitte?
Yeah, we talked
about
that.
All right, all right. So back to you. Where were you going now?
Okay. So, all right. So now we've talked about Jean Lafitte, and we've talked about New Orleans, and we've talked about lots of male pirates. But you know, there were some gals that got into it too.
Sure.
The body of knowledge is very small. So here's
okay. So here's what we'll do. So just say. So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, it'll be all about female pirates.
Gotcha.
Okay. And action.
Okay. All right. So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, it's all about the ladies.
Thank you.
I might look all sweet, but I'm a little you know what. So,
not like that.
Hey, I just, what can I tell you? So, all right, but in all seriousness, we know of at least 5 female pirates that sort of made the top most fearsome 5. So, I'm going to go ahead and let you know. One was a Cheng Yi Sao, and she was Chinese. Mm-hmm. There was, of course, Anne Bonny. She was Irish.
She's famous.
That's right. Mary Read, who is also famous. Mm-hmm. Anne Bonny and Mary Read are sort of the two you hear the most about.
Right, right, right.
There's Grace O'Malley.
Yes, Grace O'Malley. Sure do. There are a couple of bars named after her.
Oh, there you go. You know you're a famous female pirate when they name a bar after you. You have arrived. And finally, Rachel Wall.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to start with Cheng Yi Sao. She, like most, and again, this is, I guess I'm going to back up and I'm going to say, you know, years ago, and not too many years ago, as a woman, especially in the 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th century, take your pick, you didn't have a whole lot of options. So again, you were married, you had children, or you worked, you were a prostitute. This indeed is how Cheng Yi Sao started out. She started out as a courtesan to a very famous Chinese corsair. She married him, and when he died, she took over his pirate empire. She commanded over 200 ships and 50,000 people in the early part of the 19th century. She pirated for years, had children, had grandchildren, ended up being wise with her fortune, retiring, and dying a very happy lady at a ripe old age. So that's Cheng Yi Sao.
That's not what you'd think of as a typical pirate story.
It isn't, and I think she really beat the odds. She obviously was a very wise, wise lady.
Mm-hmm.
Anne Bonny started off as the illegitimate daughter of an Irish lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
And so to hide this illegitimate daughter, her father, the attorney, dressed her up as a boy and kept her as a law clerk. Eventually she decided she'd had enough of that. She ran away. She married a sailor. He died. And she signed on with a guy, and I think we've heard of this guy, Calico Jack Rackham.
Mm-hmm.
She signed on with his crew. They had a fling for a while. And after that, along comes Mary Read. Now, Mary Read only sailed one voyage for a couple of months with Calico Jack and Anne Bonny, but apparently she had a real fearsome reputation. At one point, when the pirate hunters were coming after them, and the male pirates were cowering below in utter fear, Mary Read is purported to have gotten up on the bowsprit and said, "Arr, if there's any of you be real men down there, come up and fight like the men ye are." Well, we don't really know how that ended, but we do know how the career of these two women ended. They were apprehended, of course, by the Royal Navy, the pirate catchers. They went to the assizes. They were tried. Calico Jack Rackham was hanged. But the two women evaded the noose by how, what they called in the day, pleading their bellies. They were both pregnant. About that, I say no more because I really don't know what happened. Actually, Anne Bonny went on to die of a ripe old age. Mary Read, unfortunately, died of a fever in prison. Now we come to Grace O'Malley. Grace O'Malley was an Irish pirate, part of a very, very influential Irish Hibernian clan back in the 1500s. She's one of the earliest pirates we can talk about. She eventually, again, married, became a widower, and decided that she was going to get a piece of what her clan was after, and decided to send agents after any ships that came into their territory. She became so infamous, so notorious, that the British royalty took notice of her. They sent pirate catchers to catch her. She was apprehended. She said by that time she was 65 years old. So she pulled the age card and she said, "Oh, I'm but a poor, tired old woman. Would you please give me leave to go back and live my life with my children and grandchildren?" Well, Queen Elizabeth I believed her, right? She went back, went right back to pirating, evaded the noose, evaded the court, and again died of a ripe old age surrounded by children and grandchildren. Finally, we come to Rachel Wall. Rachel Wall. She was the one with the bars, right? Rachel Wall?
Gracie O'Malley.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, that's right. By the way, so Rachel Wall is one of the only documented female American pirates. She was born in the early 18th century in Massachusetts. She decided that she did not like being a farm wife. She, again, ran off, married a sailor. He died, and she began a pirating all on her own. Again, one of the only American pirates. She pirated for about 3 years, was finally apprehended, and was the last woman actually hanged in the state of Massachusetts in 1782. So there you have our famous lady pirates. I am sure that just like there were many undocumented women who fought during the American Civil War as men, mm-hmm. if you think about the kind of opportunities that women had in those days, I would bet that so many more decided to just take a chance, put on the pants, and run away to sea. So there's a little bit more. So we're gonna go ahead and take a break, and we'll be right back.
Oh yeah, it's like the reenactor man.
It was
man
a
purse.
Wonderful time. Yes. Uh-huh. Next year, make sure you come. Yeah,
oh,
don't
yes,
miss it.
Definitely. It's always
cheers.
Fun, I think.
Chips Ahoy!
Fun's for all.
Chips Ahoy!
I stole that from her.
You were in the Harbor Shack gift store.
Yeah, Harbor Shack gift store.
We help Pirates Wenches, and we help anybody else who would love to come to our store.
Farewell to our fierce ladies of the sea. So fare thee well, female pirates. So I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Time Capsule, where we took you back in history to see what pirate life was really like. So join us next time on the Time Capsule with Cheryl Williams.
Fare thee well, the princes, landing stage, River Mersey, fare thee well. I'm bound to California, a place I know right well. So fare thee well, my own true love, when I return united we will be. It's not the leaving of Liverpool that grieves me, but my darling, when I think of you. Oh, Shenandoah, how long to hear you, far away, you rolling river. Oh, Shenandoah, how long to hear you, away.